Hello everyone, we are here with Professor Yoram Yovell, which is an expert in effective neuroscience. And we are here to ask him a few questions which you asked us before. And the first question will be, is monogamy possible in human beings?
Oh, the short answer is yes. Yeah.
Okay.
It seems to be the default mode. Almost all human societies have a form of monogamy in them. It's very rare to see societies that have evolved with other models of raising children or being together. There's certainly people who can keep it for life, and then the question is how much of this is genetic and how much of this is societal, brought about by conventions, by culture, by tradition, etc. And there are many theories to explain why monogamy evolved and why we tend towards monogamy. I'm a little bit suspicious about all those theories because they come from evolutionary psychology. And evolutionary psychology is like an interpretation of the Bible. Mm-hmm. You get a long explanation, and the result of the explanation is what's actually written. So we have very good explanations to explain what we see before our eyes, and how would we know if they would be wrong? But be that as it may, the prominent explanation for this is that it's very, very difficult to raise a single human cub. Mm-hmm. That in infancy is long, it's complicated, and that it's just too much for one person, even if that person is as endowed and as effective as a mother. So more is needed, and that's why monogamy evolved. There are many theories as to how that happened, but I think that all we can say for sure is that that's the prominent social structure in which children are raised throughout the human race, and for as long back as we can ascertain. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, so the next question is, sexual attraction is something genetic or is
definitely
cultural?
Yes, no. Well, no, mm-hmm. Sexual attraction is the building block of natural selection. It's there wouldn't be evolution in multicellular organisms. It has to do with sexual selection. Sexual attraction and sexual preferences are under very, very strong evolutionary control and selection. So it's no wonder that they've evolved to be as complex as we see them in the animal kingdom, and as important as they are in humans. And of course, they contribute to the ability to leave your genes in the gene pool before you leave for good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can love last forever? I mean, not only, friendship and so on.
Oh, romantic love. Can love last? Well, that's a great question. Stephen Mitchell, who is a psychoanalyst, who wrote a book called Can Love Last, in which he deals with this question from a psychoanalytic perspective, he put it very succinctly. He says, safety kills romance. And I think that is very, very true. Because I think when it comes to love, there are two drives, there are two goals that we aspire to. And those goals are mutually contradictory. On the one hand, people aspire to feel safe, to feel like the person whom they love loves them and will always be there, and that they can count on this love and it'll be stable. And on the other hand, they seek adventure and they seek variance and they seek palpitations and butterflies in the stomach and uncertainty. And that's part of what gives romance its exciting, addictive flavor. Trouble is, they don't go hand in hand. As love becomes safer, it becomes more taken for granted. It becomes less exciting. It becomes less
boring.
It can become boring. It can become more boring. And so the question of the stability of love relationships basically has to do with, would we be able to develop something else as that excitement, novelty, the parts that have fueled the romantic interest and the sexual attraction in the first place, as they wane to some extent. So they don't, if they go away completely, that's bad. If you get partnerships that are sexless, that's not very good. It can happen. There's a lot of that going on by necessity. But I think it's hard for people to be happy that way. I think being in a sexual relationship is part of what makes life worth living for most people. But the strength of this energy within a couple relationship wanes over time. And therefore, people use many tricks to keep it alive. Fantasy, games, sexuality is involved in many pretend and make-believe and rituals and stuff like that. And that is in part to add flavor. But I think the dominant process that happens in most people is that in exchange for that decreasing sexuality, you get a development of what can be called friendship or affiliation. It's sort of this mutual bond of deep friendship between two people that are like very, very good friends, and they come to trust each other and to like each other and to want to nurture each other. And that, under favorable circumstances, that will more than compensate for what you lose in that mm-hmm. bright excitement of the first it can be from first few days to the first few years, but it's hard to keep that for 60 years. And I think the longer we live, and it looks like we're heading towards longevity as a race, as a species, I think it'll be more of a challenge to keep it.
Yeah, certainly. So my last question is, how love is wired in the brain? I mean, all kind of love are wired the same way or different?
Yeah, well, that's, you know, this is the difference between a good question and an excellent question. So excellent questions are the ones you know the answer for. And I can say that affective neuroscience, the neuroscience of emotions, has really tackled that problem. And we're far from understanding everything, but we do know quite a bit about the basic emotional circuits in the brain. And I would liken these to the keys of a piano, in the sense that we know the basic notes, but each of us plays his or her own music, or life plays its music upon us by different touches and different nuances and different combinations of those basic structures. People used to wonder whether such a thing as basic emotions exist at all. And there have been prominent theories in psychology stating that there are no real basic emotions. And what we call emotions are really the results of two continuous variables, such as whether something is pleasant or unpleasant, and the intensity of the stimulus. And there's reason to believe that that's not the case, that we do have these basic discrete emotional circuits that have evolved through evolution, that are very well conserved in all mammals, so that when I'll describe them to human beings, that's true for all mammals, and probably for all birds as well, but certainly for all mammals. Jak Panksepp, who's the father of affective neuroscience, really one of the most prominent neuroscientists who lived, I was fortunate to be his student. Later, he was my mentor, later he was my colleague, and unfortunately he passed away last year. He defined seven key emotional circuits in the human brain, all grounded in older parts of the central nervous system, those that we share with, so not so much in the neocortex, especially in the heteromodal neocortex, that is part of what gave us our cognitive abilities as a species, but in the older parts of the brain, the limbic system, the hypothalamus, the midbrain, so older structures that are well conserved in all mammals. And those seven systems, out of those seven systems, there are four that have to do with love and its basic variations as we know them. One of those systems is called the seeker, the seeking system. And you can think about it as our non-specific main motivational engine. That's the system that makes us want things. Mm-hmm. Almost everything that we want by the activity of that system. We can see that during depression, for example, one of the things that happened is that that system is diminished and people stop liking things. We call it anhedonia, when they no longer enjoy things and they no longer seek them. So that underlies all kinds of love. And then there's the system that's called lust. And that, of course, has to do with sexual attraction, but not only. It has to do with everything that's rewarding. And from that perspective, a beauty queen is like a chocolate cake. The kind of neural circuitry that they arouse in people is more similar than we would like to admit. And then there are two other systems. One is a system that called care or nurturance. And that's a system that was evolved in mammals so that we would be able to take care of our young ones because they can't survive on their own. And that's, if you will, an altruistic system that makes you, and this is interesting because we used to think that human beings, like animals, were born bad and they have to be acculturated in order to become good. And that apparently is simply not the case. So it's not that we're not born bad, we are, but we're also born good. The vast majority of human beings have the circuitry, the natural circuitry in them to take care of other people, to sacrifice their own good for the good of other people. And I think part of the tasks of good parenting is not to spoil that. So we have that system too. And when I was alluding beforehand to the intensity of the sexual attraction waning over time in couples and something else taking its place, it's in many ways this system, this kind of affiliative friendship that wanting to take care of someone that comes in its place. And then there's a system that's called loss or panic or grief. Mm-hmm. And that's a system that evolved for separation distress. And that's a system that is strong in infants, in cubs, in puppies, in young animals, young mammals. And when they're separated from their attachment figure, usually their mother, they emit a cry, and that cry is similar in all mammalian species, and it sounds like this. Babies do it, puppies do it, kittens do it, monkeys do it, all mammals do it, and we recognize it and we respond to it. And this system is important for human love because in most mammalian species, this system is only active in the animals as when they're young. And as they mature sexually, they lose it so that they don't develop these very, very strong emotional bonds. Whereas in human beings, it persists throughout the life cycle. We call the phenomenon of the persistence of traits that are characteristic of young animals for the rest of their life, we call it neoteny. And if human beings are a species in which neoteny is very strong, the many characteristics that we have that are baby-like, for example, the ratio of the size of our heads versus the rest of our bodies, the fact that there's not a lot of hair on most of our bodies, and there's also psychological neoteny. And two examples are the fact that, like cubs and puppies and kittens, we're curious. Most animals lose that as they grow older. Everyone knows how curious kittens are. When cats become older, they become lazy, and it's going to be very hard to make them play, whereas kittens are playful. And from that perspective, dogs are neotenized wolves. So, it's basically the same species, but dogs have been selected or have been self-selected for being curious and being able to form these intense emotional connections into adulthood, and that's why they easily glom onto us as human beings, and they're so loyal and so faithful and so friendly because they've kept that trait throughout their lives and they focus it on us. And from that perspective, human beings are also playful. And we're curious throughout life, et cetera, et cetera. Now, one thing that comes with that neoteny is the fact that we keep the ability to have strong attachments and to feel intense sorrow and intense sadness and intense anxiety when our love object is pulled away from us or distances him or herself from us. And that's something very, very prominent in romantic love. You can hear it, I would say that most of the songs, most of what you hear, most of the music that's generated in the world, songs, rock groups, etc. This is what they sing about. You know, I had a lover and he left me, and now I'm miserable. And if you leave me, I don't know what I'll do to myself, etc., etc. So that's something that's very prominent in human love. Now, these are the basic components, and every kind of love, for example, sexual romantic love, would have a measure of lust in it, as well as seek, as it will evolve later, it will have care in it. It definitely has loss. Without loss, you don't really have anything that we call love. So from that perspective, we can give a straight answer to the question, does love always hurt? So there's an answer. The answer is yes, of course. Yeah. If it doesn't, I would. It's that emotional pain is the sine qua non of love. Mm-hmm. Meaning that if there's no emotional pain, it's not love. That doesn't mean that if there's emotional pain, it is necessarily love, because there are many things that cause emotional pain, such as abusing someone, such as dependence, things that are not good but they hurt. So the fact that something, that an emotional relationship hurts, doesn't yet mean that it's love. But if it doesn't hurt, you can make sure it ain't. You can be sure that it ain't love. So that's a necessary ingredient of human love, is that feeling of longing and of anxiety that you're going to lose whom you love, and that's part of our emotional repertoire. Mm-hmm. So there you are.
So thank you so much. It was fascinating. Yeah. I learned a lot, especially how similar we are, human beings, to mammals.
Oh, we definitely are. We definitely are. Yeah, amazing. Yeah. I think it should give us pause. I think that just understanding this would make you vegetarian. No kidding. It did. It made me vegetarian.
I'm vegan.
Yes, you are. Yeah, yeah. I think once you understand, it becomes inevitable. I think that's where we're moving here.